Because it is a different way to think about statistical methods and data analysis than what I think you guys are used to, for sure. I mean, I've been kind of prepping you for this all along in the OLF 7 sort of thing. But now we're kind of upping the game, so to speak, to general probability models. So if you think about a common approach to data analysis, we observe data, let's say, in this class, for right now, let's just think about a univariate response yi, and then some vector of covariates xi, I equal 1 to n. Extend this thing to a vector thing so that we observe a multivariate y on choice. And we've talked a lot about this. I mean, you know, this is an easy statement for a statistician. This Hagenau methodology is sit here and make, like, you observe this. But if you're doing kind of data analysis, where does this come from? Who are you generalizing to? All those things that go back, right? So that's a very loaded number one there. You've got to think about it. Well, maximum likelihood estimation, we know that it leads to nice properties, right? So, you know what? I'm sorry. We need like a, we're going to call this a 3, and we're going to call this a 2. And what we need to do here is specify say a regression model. Right? And what I mean by that is the mean law. That's the thing that's answering the scientific question that we're dealing with, okay? So that's obviously got to come into play here as well. In our class, we've been thinking about GLMs, so back in the 211 days, and then even in the 210 days, you were thinking about the linear regression model, just about the case of the GLM. So what you were doing was you were saying, okay, I'm going to think about some mean function, g of mu I, mu I is the mean of yi, and I'm going to relate that to a linear predictor now of my covariates and my unknown regression parameters beta. And again, the specification of that model is defined by what you're trying to answer scientifically. Okay, so that leads us all into many of the comments that we have previously made about confounding, precision, etc. And so then we know, the question is well, how do I estimate beta? We know the maximum likelihood estimation leads to optimal properties. For the estimate of beta at specify the probability distribution for yi, I equal 1 to n. So we're going to have this, we might suppose that yi is distributed with some PDF f, coming from its probability distribution, and that thing is going to be a function of beta in xi. So now, this allows us to formulate the likelihood which in the case where I've got independence, is going to be the product of each of those guys. From that, I'll obtain the score function, which is going to be the first derivative of the log likelihood. From that, I will solve the score equation. And then we know that if I've done that and I've specified that distribution yi correctly, or for yi, then I know I get certain optimality properties out of this guy in regular problems. And we talked about what those regularity conditions are. But again, just very quickly, give me those optimality properties. You should be able to rattle them off like nothing right now. Or do you always begin with an estimator? What do you want first? I think before that, even consistency, right? Because I can be unbiased and not consistent. Okay, so I can be always up, down, 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 down. So I'd never be consistent depending on my sample size. So consistency first. What else would we like to have? Efficiency. So the MLE is going to get us that asymptotically, right? We know that the MLE is going to achieve the Rao-Kramer lower bound. So it's going to have smaller sampling variability than any other consistent estimator in regular problems. Good. What else do we want to know? What was it? Normality. We'd like to know its distribution, right? The idea is we want to draw inference on beta, the unknown population parameter, so we need to know also something about its distribution. So we get that as well. Okay. So fantastic. That's what we need for inference on beta, and we can do it now efficiently, and we know we're consistent. That's all under the presumption that I've specified that guy correctly. Okay, so that's kind of setting the stage for where we are. Good. So what we did last time, and what I think as a data analysis analyst you need to do, and when you're thinking about methodology, you need to think about this because there's no sense in generating methodology that's never going to be applied to real data, I will argue. So what you need to come back to is say, well, what do I really know about the distribution of f? You can't prove that it's a particular distribution in most cases. Unless yi is binary and I've got independence, then I know that f is a Bernoulli. Okay? But other than that, I generally cannot prove to myself that I've correctly specified that distribution. So we did last time is we said, well, let's suppose that the true CDF is G, I'm going to put a little GI there because it's going to be defined by parameters in the mean model, etc., the covariates XI. And so it's GI, not FI. Okay, so FI being the capital C of that PDF sitting up there that we started off by assuming. What you have to ask yourself then is you go through and you do this in practice. Now, what actually are the properties of that beta hat if you were wrong in specifying it? That's the whole point here, right? So to try and be robust in the specification of the underlying probability distribution. So Hubert White told us that the following is going to hold, right? That beta hat, that thing that you solved by assuming that the distribution of the y's was f, is going to converge in distribution still under the same weak regularity conditions that we've had before, by the way. So it's going to converge in distribution to a normal. That's great. That's back where we were with the MLE. Got to love the central limit there and there. It's going to have mean zero. I'm going to tell you what beta star is in just a second. We're going to remind ourselves of what beta star is. And it's going to have this variant that looks like A in inverse BA inverse. And the question is, well, what is B star, or beta star? It's the value of beta such that when I take the expectation under the true distribution G, of my score that was obtained by specifying F to begin with, that thing is equal to zero. So it's the solver, if you will, for that estimating equation. Okay? So we can put a little A there if you want. B is, start off with B. And then A. B is, tell me what capital A is over there. Expectation of the derivative of the score minus the expectation of the derivative of the score. So it's the Fisher information, what we've been calling under F. And then capital B is what? What is it?
It's variance.
It's the true variance of the score under G, right? So I've come up with this thing U. Now, U really doesn't mean anything. It's not magical anymore. It's just, it's what I had come across when I assumed F. So now I've got this estimating function. And so G is just the variance of that estimating function, but under the true distribution now. That's the variance G. And again, to take it back home for us, we know that if we had started off by specifying F correctly to begin with, then the variance of the score is the Fisher information. And so therefore, B and A inverse would cancel out, and we get back to the good old MLE result that we always had, Fisher information inverse. Okay, so that's what we had shown last time. But again, this is the reality when you're dealing with real-world data, okay, and you don't know what that F is, that you need to be thinking about what is the correct variance, what I've estimated. The normality, you kind of come for free, Lindbergh-Eller central limit theorem, comes for free with those regularity conditions. Beta star, I have argued that beta star is defined by the scientific question, and the reason why I worry less about it is because what kind of estimating equations have we been dealing with? Unbiased estimating equations, meaning that their expectation runs into expectation of y minus the mean, whatever you specified the mean to be. Go back up to number two up there, okay, based upon my scientific question. Okay, so I'll be consistent for whatever that mean was at the end of the day. Okay? So what I really need to think about then is working up the variance. Okay? All right. So now let's put that into practice with the Beagle's data. Any questions on that before I get rolling?
Did you say that, is there a situation where we have to worry about beta star?
Where I would need to worry about beta star? Yes, and I'm going to show you one, right? So I'm going to show you an example in lecture four where people have come up with estimating functions that are not only specifying the first moment, they also specify the second moment. And in those cases, that means you're going to have to get the mean and the variance correctly specified to get the same consistency on both. You don't get the mean for free anymore. So I will show you in just a second. It's a great question. Good. So let me bring that back down. All
on.
Everybody cross your fingers. Or maybe you're thinking, no, cross my fingers that it doesn't come up, so we don't have to move on. I can see it perfectly on my monitor up here, so I know it's easy.
It's making noise now.
Sasha's giving up, she's had enough. Oh wait, there we are, fantastic. Okay, so that was our result that we just now had, no, I was replicating. I did in terms of the general beta last time when we were proving things. Again, we use beta when we're talking about the mean parameters in a regression model or a linear predictor. So now let's go to the Beatles example. Last time, again, I introduced the example. The idea here was you're trying to investigate what the, if you will, dose response relationship between a fumigant is and its ability to kill off brain beetles. Okay, and the way that the experiment is done, which is a common experiment in these settings, is you take multiple jars or environments. Force the beetles into those jars or environments. You put some food in there, but you also put in a certain level or concentration of the fumigant, and then you wait some period of time, and then you go back and you count how many beetles are deceased at that point in time. Okay, so that's a success in our particular case. Now again, you can think about all of this as I've got a bunch of 0-1 responses. Every beetle that I have is a 0 or 1. They either died, success, or they live, failure. In this particular case. But you have inherent clustering that's going on here. You have clustering through the jars, and we talked about that last time. So really, the way that I would term this type of problem is it's like a grouped binomial problem, okay? Where you have inherent grouping that's coming from the jars. That grouping is likely to induce correlation, and we talked about multiple reasons why that would be. It's competition for resources, it may be different jar effects, things that are actually happening inside of the jar, but the point is that the propensity to die for beetles within the same jar comes more similar, so you've got correlation there. So you don't have just independence across all of these binary responses, which means at the end of the day, your data are not truly binomial if you looked at them as a whole, okay? But there is correlation that's going on inside of each of the jars. And in lecture one, we showed that will change the variance relationship relative to a truly binomial problem. Okay? So last time we went through the data. One key point here, I brought up one thing already for you guys. Let me make this kind of bigger so you guys can see it here. These were all of the data. One thing I highlighted last time was that there are two kind of funny situations that we might have to deal with statistically, right? One is a jar where we have 30 of 30 beetles deceased. And the other is a jar where we have none of the 24 beetles deceased. So basically, if you're looking just in those jars, you've got no information on the probability of death versus survival in terms of the variance estimate. The variance estimate in this case is going to be 0. Okay. That's one thing. The other thing I want to point out here, because it's going to come up a little bit later, I'm going to come back and refer to it, is the fact that we've got a fairly uniform denominator across the jars. Okay. What I mean by that is it's approximately 30 across all these because it's a designed experiment. Now, if I as a statistician were involved in the design, this would be 30, right? It wouldn't be a lab tech kind of just grabbing a handful of beetles and throwing them in and saying there's going to be 31 in this one or 24 in this one. It would be 30 uniformly. And I'll talk about why that's going to become important for us in just a little bit. It's going to give us a couple of relationships between some of the mean variance functions that we have. The fact that we've got uniformity or rough uniformity across the jars. Again, in observational study settings, you don't get that luxury oftentimes. You often have high variation across the different clusters. I gave you guys the example of saying, suppose I sampled classrooms at UCI, okay? And I talked about whether my outcome was fail or pass at the end of the day, at the end of the quarter. That's a classic grouped binomial experiment. There is correlation within the classroom for failing versus passing. You all share the same instructor when you're in the same classroom. That's one reason, same topic, etc. But when you do that experiment at UCI, now you have correlation within the classroom, but you also have very high variation in the denominator counts, right? You go sample some, you know, early freshman class, like say step 7, it's gonna have 220 people in it, whereas you guys have the luxury of having 21 plus the paid audience members that are filling seats. So there you're gonna have high variation, and that's gonna, you're gonna see, is gonna have an impact on the way we might estimate people over dispersion in the model. Okay. All right. Good. So what we did last time, I'm gonna jump back into R in a minute, but I'll run through the slides for right now, is I simply said, let's take log concentration. I knew something about the model fitting already here. And let's fit a GLM, where now I'm fitting, bring it up for you guys so you can see it again. My GLM call is nothing more than the observed proportion with inside of each jar, so the number affected divided by the number of exposed as a function of log concentration. So just a simple logistic regression model is what I'm fitting here. And I know that because I put family equals binomial, so that means that my default is a logistic function. The only other key thing for you guys is that when you're dealing with binomial data like this, where you've got total counts in the denominators, you need to put in the weight at the end of the day, right? If you just stick in affected over exposed, R is going to yell at you, and rightfully so. It's because you would be telling it that affected divided by exposed follows a binomial distribution, but it's not even discrete, okay? So when you put in the weights, it knows that the numerator for that thing is the discrete random variable that is binomially distributed. Okay. All right. Good, good, good. So what we had done then is I said, okay, well, let's consider that model. And consider the goodness of fit for it. So I first started off by simply doing an empirical assessment of the goodness of fit. In other words, have I correctly specified the functional form of concentration? It's the only variable that I have here, the only covariate that I have. So can't really go wrong in terms of specifying other things going on. But what about the functional form? Is the log transformation reasonable in this case? So what I did last time was I created what I called eta observed. Remember, eta always means my linear predictor in a GLM context. And so eta observed is just my empirical linear predictor. So all I'm doing is taking the empirical log odds. And I noted last time that I'm adding a half to each of those, and that's because I've got the situation where I've got all successes or all failures in two of my jars, okay? So this is, and someone had asked me a very good question, says, you know, is there any theoretical reason for a half? And the answer is no, it's very ad hoc. It just gets me some stability in that estimate because I'm doing this for a diagnostic here, okay? It's a very common thing that we do when we have zero counts in discrete data. And we want to just estimate an empirical, say, linear predictor like this. So then what I did was I said, okay, now let's go to the model fit. And so I took my model fit and I created eta hat here. So eta hat is based upon the log concentration linear predictor, and then plotted those things. And when we did that, we came up with this plot. And I love this example because this is real data, and this is about as pretty of a logit plot as you're ever going to see in your entire life in terms of fitting, especially with this few data points. Even your log concentration is pretty far off of high leverage is fitting this line quite well. Okay. So everybody looked at this and said, yeah, that looks pretty darn good in terms of a linear fit to the logit, right, as a function of log concentration that's sitting here. So certainly nothing glaringly wrong with the functional form and how we specify it in this model. So then we said, well, okay, let's go ahead and do a goodness of fit test. Last time what I did when I did the goodness of fit test, and I want to just emphasize this one more time. Remember, a goodness of fit test based upon the deviance is a likelihood ratio test between your current model and the saturated model, okay? So there are two ways really in R that you could go about doing this. One is to truly just generate a saturated model. So in other words, a model that fits your observed data perfectly. So in order to do that, what I did was I went through and I said for each observation, that's one binomial sample here, each jar, I'll create a group indicator, call that 1 to 10, and I'll just simply fit indicators for that group. And one of the things that I noted last time is if you look at that saturated fit there, I call it fit.sat, or fit saturated, and you look at a summary of it, you get some very odd things coming out, like log odds ratios that are on the range of 25, 26, which means your estimated odds ratio in each group would be e to the 25, the 26, not realistic. And standard errors that are through the roof. The reason that that is happening is because of our two jars that have all successes and all failures, okay? So you wouldn't trust these point estimates. They have interpretations, by the way, right? This is the odds, the log odds comparing, or the difference in the log odds, I should say, comparing, say, concentration group two to concentration group one. But the point is my estimate is just off the charts. And that's because my variance is blown off the charts because I've got two groups where I've got all successes or all failures. Right, so my p-hat is either 0 or 1, not 2.
Why can't you just, this might not even be the thing, can we just add 0.5 to the thing?
And some people would do that if they were running into numerical complexities. The reason I'm not doing it is because I don't even have to worry about it, and you're going to see why in just a second. I'm just using the saturated model here for elected ratio test for goodness of fit, and so it actually isn't going to affect me. But if I was having instability, that actually is a common trick that people will do, is they'll add just a half and give things away. Yep. Okay. So the reason why, so going back to Hina's point here, the reason why I can get away with the goodness of fit test is just go back to the log likelihood for the binomial log. If you go back to the log likelihood for the binomial model, you will see that, so n in my case is 10, that's the number of jars that I've got. Okay. Mi is the denominator that I have, the number exposed in each of those jars. And Si is the number of successes that I have, so the number of affected or dead beetles. And so what you see then is in the cases where I had all successes with inside of a jar, so log of mu I hat is equal to 1, this term here drops out and goes away to 0. This term here drops out and goes away to 0. And so, and this guy is going to be 0. And so I get 0 contribution to the log likelihood. Okay. And similarly, in the case where I have all failures, that guy's going to be 0. So this term is going to go away. Same thing here, MI is going to be 0. It'll give me a 0 contribution to the log likelihood. The key point here is that the saturated log likelihood that I would get if I were to drop those two observations is going to be the exact same. Yeah, that's with me on that? Okay, so I don't need to worry about it. Okay. So we can go ahead and trust the deviance goodness of fit test in this case. If I were dealing with binary data, would I want to trust the deviance goodness of fit test? Just truly binary data? No, right? No. Because I'm not borrowing any information here on mu I hat. Everything is a 0 or 1, so everything degenerates down to 0. Okay? I wouldn't want to do it there. And the final new case, okay. Alright, so now I'm going to jump back into R because this is going to become new stuff. So this is back where we were last time. Okay. So I'm just going to go ahead and rerun things just to make sure I'm on the same page. Going everything to the saturated model that I looked at before. And again, so that's just the recreation of the results that I had from before. Now, if I'm going to perform a deviance goodness of fit test, that's a likelihood ratio test from my current model. I call it GLM fit in my code here versus the saturated model. So my degrees of freedom on that test are 8. Where does the 8 come from? We're on the same page here.
The difference between the number of parameters and your model versus the book.
Excellent, Francis. Thank you. So yeah, the degrees of freedom on an likelihood ratio test, just always think about is the difference in the number of freely varying parameters between the full model and the reduced model. Right? So in that case, it's 8 because I have 2 parameters that are sitting in my reduced model, and I've got 10 parameters that are sitting inside of my full model, my saturated model. In this case, I have 1 parameter for every observation. Okay. All right. The key point here is the deviant statistic in this case is 36 on 8 degrees of freedom. So that's pretty extreme and unusual to observe that particular statistic. And it was distributed chi-squared with 8 degrees of freedom. So the conclusion of this goodness of fit test says your model is doing horribly, okay? Okay, in other words, you're rejecting HO, that everything that's in the saturated model that's not in your current model is equal to zero. You're rejecting the hypothesis and saying something that was left out. What we've just done, we've created this beautiful diagnostic plot that I said was one of the best I've ever seen, actually, for a functional form fit. So what's going on? Well, the question about what's going on is going to come from the fact of, do we really trust that this statistic that we generated under the binomial distribution is correct? In other words, it's derived straight off that likelihood. And if it was wrong, we shouldn't be trusting that decision. I do want to point out one other thing, though. I've been kind of manually, if you will, generating deviance goodness of fit statistics for you guys. And that's because I've been wanting to pedagogically just enforce what it is. It's this likelihood ratio test between the current saturated model. I'm getting you guys to think about what a saturated model is. There's a lot easier way of doing this. Oops. The easier way for me to do this is I've got my GLM fit already that came from my current model with log concentration in it. I can simply pull off the deviance from that model and pull off the degrees of freedom, the residual degrees of freedom, and then compare them to a chi-square. So if I do that, and don't erase it, then you will get, for the deviance that comes from the GLM fit, that will nicely equate to what we had from the saturated model versus the current model. Again, the degrees of freedom residual is 8. That's the difference in the two number of freely variable parameters between the two models. And then I would just, to compute my p-value, just compare that deviance to a chi-square distribution of 8 degrees of freedom, right? And so that's this guy with a little bit more precision for you that you don't, I don't think, need that much precision on this problem to be able to tell. Okay? So that's the quick and easy way to do a deviance goodness fit test, if you need, without having to fit the saturated model. So again, if I were dealing with these data and I came through, I would kind of be at a loss. I'd say, I don't really know what is going on in terms of a lack of fit here, given the diagnostic that we just did on the functional form and the fact that I've only got one covariate in this data set. And so, the next thing that I would be doing is I'd be coming back and saying, maybe I shouldn't trust the statistic. Maybe my assumption about the likelihood is wrong. And the very first thing that I would think about is the mean variance relationship. Okay? So if I want to investigate now the mean variance relationship, then the best tool that you have at your disposal in a GLM context is the Pearson residual. Okay, so we talked about this last time. The Pearson residual, let's see, I might even be able to write it over here just to make sure that we're all on the same page with it. So the Pearson residual is simply defined in a GLM as yi minus mu I hat its mean divided by the square root of v of mu I, the assumed variance function. Okay, that's what the Pearson residual is. We've talked about this before. If you've got an intercept in the model and a correctly specified mean model, this thing will have expectation zero. And the variance of this guy, or the expected value of EIP squared, should be approximately 1 if V of UI was specified correctly in F. Okay? So what I want to do is I want to look at the mean of my squared Pearson residuals. We talked about this last time. Normally you account for the number of parameters that you use to estimate the mean, so the degrees of freedom. So I've pulled off now my Pearson residuals. And then I'm going to pull off the number of observations that I have. That's just 10 in my case. And so my estimate then of what I've been calling phi, which is that over dispersion parameter throughout my notes, is now going to be essentially the mean of those squared Pearson residuals. Okay? And so I'm going to sum up those squared Pearson residuals. I'm going to divide by n minus p in this case, because I've used 2 degrees of freedom to fit my model with, just to make mu. And before going on to the punchline here, if my model was again specified correctly, I would hope that this thing would be close to 1. Okay? I would say that my binomial assumption about the variance problem would be correct. And lo and behold, in this particular case, it's about 4.2. And everything is relative, but you've got an interpretation here. What this is telling you is that your The observed variance that you're seeing in your data are approximately 4.2 times bigger than what they are by your assumption, from your assumption. Okay? And that's huge for us. Okay? That's like assuming that you have four times more data in your data set for your precision than you actually have. Okay? So that's a huge Pearson statistic in this case. That tells me that there is a large correlation among beetles in these jars. They're not close to biology. Okay? All right, so now we realize just from this alone, this tells me my assumption of a binomial family is not correct. So I, then when I go back and I look at summary of GLM fit, oops, not vert, but fit. When I go back to this thing, the key thing here is it says, oh, the dispersion parameter for the binomial family is taken to be one. It's assumed to be one. That's what's used to create these standard errors and estimate them. I can't trust them. Okay, those guys are off. If I can't trust the standard errors, that means the z value there that's off, and that means also that p value that's resulting there is off. And if I go into my GLMCI function that you guys have on the course webpage, where I actually produce what I would consider to be useful information, this would be the confidence interval that would result for the log concentration, one unit increase. This thing is going to be off as well because it's based upon that same model-based standard error. Okay? All right. Good. By the way, that's a very big odds ratio. That's a one unit change in the log concentration. If I were doing this in practice and presenting it to somebody, realize that a one unit change in the log concentration is bigger than the observed range of your data that you actually have. So you want to scale that down. Divided by at least 10. Right? Talk about a 0.1 unit change in log concentration. Or talk about a multiplicative increase in concentration, which somebody told me about last time. Bring it back on the concentration scale. Okay. Good, good, good. So now, Houston, we have a problem. We need to fix the problem. So we're going to appeal to Huber White to fix the problem. And we're going to look at a few different tools here. Oops. We're not gonna look at that tool. I think we're gonna look at a few different tools. I get the daisy chain of death that I'm going to do here. The daisy grid. Sorry about that. Oops. Then you're going to edit all of this out, right? It's all going to be seamless. It's going to look like, you know, there are never any technical difficulties. All yep. The errors that I'm making, I'm not making errors. Those will all be removed from this video.
And you'll be airbrushed.
I'll be airbrushed. I do need that, actually, as well. That should actually come first. All right. Back in the saddle. Just just go with it, right? Just assume that they are still binomial, despite the fact that you've got overwhelming evidence that would say that they're probably not. So that's what we actually just did. So don't do that. That's not going to be a good fix. The next one that we're going to think about is what we're going to call a quasi-binomial fix. And so what we're going to do, so you can think about quasi-binomial is like thinking about, okay, the data are kind of like binomial, okay? And what we mean by kind of binomial is that the mean variance relationship looks like a mu times mu minus mu times denominator, but we're off by a constant scale, and we're going to call that phi. In our case, we estimated it already, and that phi was 4.2, roughly. Okay. The next is what we're going to call a beta binomial model. Okay. And the beta binomial model, you guys have actually already seen before, once on homework in the full likelihood setting, but actually in lecture one, the beta binomial mean variance relationship comes from assuming you got an exchangeable correlation with the inside of each of the jars. That I've got rho is the correlation for two beetles within a given jar. And that rho is data constant across the jar. Okay. And then the last one is going to be what I'm going to call an unspecified mean variance relationship. So what, in other words, we're going to just try and fix up the variance without making a particular assumption on how we can specify the mean variance relationship. Okay. So let's write down an appeal to Huber-White for each of these guys. Remember, Huber-White says we need to figure out what A was and we need to figure out what B was under each of these particular cases. So we start off by saying, well, what was the mean model that we fit? The mean model was nothing more than logits of mu I. Oops, I should have an xi up there times beta, right? So I got a mu I there. So it should be xi in that particular case. And so let's go ahead and derive to make sure that we're on the same page these AN's and BN's that I have on the next two slides that are sitting here under each of these different misspecified assumptions. So, xi beta, where xi in this case is the ith row of the design matrix. Okay. That's the notation that I'm using here. So it's the ith observations covariate values. So what we need to do then is, if you recall, from last lecture, An is equal to 1 over n sum I equal 1 to n xi transpose what I'm calling wi xi, where wi, you can think about it as your weight in the iterative reweight of least squares algorithm from the GLM, is equal to d mu, ai of I times b of mu I. And then we also need to think about the link. Okay? So in our particular case here, what we've got is, because we're going to have to deal with the transformation of the link. Let me go over to this. Di, which was defined in last lecture as well, the case of a GLM, which is just the derivative of my mean with respect to my parameter vector, in this case beta. Use the chain rule, that's d mu I d eta I times d eta I d beta. Rewrite this guy here as d eta I, that's the linear predictor, the logit of mu I d mu I inverse. And luckily for us, d eta I d beta, since that's just the linear predictor, that's just going to give me back xi. So just have xi times beta. Well, this is just the derivative of the logit. Do some math for me. You will see that this ultimately ends up being mu I times 1 minus mu I for this particular guy. And then I've got my xi hanging off. Make sure that you get back that same calculation. So I will need that di as well when I compute e. So now, what this means for us then is an, which is just our estimate of the Fisher information, if we had correctly specified the binomial model, looks like xi transpose, in my case now, that guy up there, that ai phi of d is mu I under the binomial model. Once I put in my d and my w, it's going to be mi times mu I times 1 minus mu I times xi. Okay, so go back and match up exactly what you've got there. Here's your WI up here. I guess we could go ahead and write this down for us if we want. In the case of the binomial. So for a binomial response, that WI would just be mu I times 1 minus mu I over mi. Again, what I'm taking is my binomial and dividing by the sample size, so that would be the variance of that estimated proportion into the binomial model. Okay. So S over M in my particular case in the notes. So now, putting those two things together, you're going to get back to your AN, which is going to look like XI transpose MI times mu I times 1 minus mu I times XI. Again, this is kind of nice. This is actually just the variance of yi of yi was truly binomial, right? Sample size times mu times 1 minus mu. Okay. So now I could write this thing then as 1 over n big design matrix transpose v big design matrix. So just bringing out the sum, writing it in matrix notation. With v now just being the diagonal matrix. With mi, mu I, 1 minus mu I, down the diagonal. And again, this thing here, inverse, is what you're getting back for the variance covariance matrix from the binomial model for the GLM. Okay? All right. Good. Good, good. So now, let's think about what bn would be. Thank you.
even going to be? Under the beta binomial. Model. And really what we mean by this is, i.e., if we assume that the correlation between two observations in the same jar is this constant rho, okay? So an exchangeable, again, correlation matrix with inside of the jar. So everybody, any two observations have correlation rho. So that was all in question there. So in this case then, from what we did last time, Bn is going to have the following form. It's going to look like 1 over n sum I equals 1 to n. I'll get my di transpose, the transformation on the link. I'll have wi. Those were, again, the weights that I would have been using if I specified my likelihood function correctly, the binomial in this case. We have what I called last time bi star. That's the true variance. And then we have wi di. So putting the pieces together in this case, it would be 1 over n sum I equal 1 to n xi transpose, bring in the wi. Once I do that, I'll get an mi over a mu I times 1 minus mu I times, now what would have been my true variance for the ith observation under the beta binomial model? We've derived that on the first day of class. That would have been mu I times 1 minus mu I. And then you get this extra term that's coming over here. You're going to get a 1 plus a rho mi minus 1. And that whole thing would then get divided by mi, the denominator. And we're not done yet. Now I have to have wi and di. So again, this is bi star underneath the beta binomial model that we had derived on the first day of class. And then finally, I need a times. I get a wi again. That's just mi over mu I, 1 minus mu I. And then finally, a times mu I times 1 minus mu I. Finally, xi. Okay. Good. So that's going to get us to Bn. So a little bit of simplification of that. And you should have a 1 over n sum I equal 1 to n xi transpose mi times mu I times 1 minus mu I, and then hitting that by the factor that we had before from the beta binomial model, the 1 plus rho mi minus 1 times an xi, once everything is come through and simplified. So that means that I can write this thing down in matrix notation as big design matrix X transpose. The thing that I'm going to call B star now, which is that variance under the beta binomial model, good. So now, if my true correlation structure were of this beta binomial form, then the estimates that I got out of fitting that GLM, the variance covariance for them, would be
inverse, B, A and inverse. You guys with me? Okay. And right now, what R is putting out for us is just A and inverse. Okay. All right. Good deal. Yes.
So what is MI?
MI is the sample size within each jar, right? So it's the denominator for each of my binomial experiments. Good. All right. So that's the harder one to deal with because we have to compute B in. If I assume the quasi-binomial model where I'm just off by a constant phi, then what's going to happen? Yeah, this thing is just going to look like a constant, right? And so that means that Bn is just going to be a constant times An. Are you guys with me on that? And so that means to fix the variances under that model, all I have to do is multiply A inverse by phi. Right? We'll get back to that. Okay, just this nice constant. So that one becomes easy. Okay. So let me go back into the notes, and we'll just write down the summation here. By the way, this very nice form here, you don't always get that super nice form of like X transpose B star X. That is coming from where you're using the canonical link, actually, so things are canceling out. You normally have to go through the entire process. Oops, don't need that. So again, under the scale model, the quote-unquote quasi-binomial model, the variance of yi just equals some constant scale factor phi, so that means bn is just equal to phi times an. So that one becomes easier. Under the beta binomial model, this is what we derived that variance to be on lecture one, so I get back this bn, which is what we just now derived over here. And so, what is going to be the ultimate variance at the end of the day for each of these models? Well, if you go with the general binomial model, that's what we already fit. That's just going to be my good old X transpose B X inverse. My scale model will be whatever we estimated phi to be times that guy. And then finally, under the beta binomial model, I will get back 1 over n A and inverse B and A and inverse. And so I have this large, if you will, sandwich that's coming there. I'm sandwiching the true variance of the score between what the variance of the score would have been if I had specified the model for it. I.E. Fisher. So, there's one other that I said though. And the fourth one is to say, well, okay, how do you know that you truly have this just nice constant times the binomial variance? The answer is you don't. Or how do you know that you really have this nice exchangeable correlation structure with inside of the jars, that there's this constant rho between any two needles with inside of the jar, and that stays constant to give you this? And the answer is you really don't. And so you might be unwilling, or at least skeptical, to assume either of these are going to truly fix your problem. Now, they will do better, certainly, than the binomial. You know the binomial is way off. You know that on average, it's off by a factor of 4. So if nothing else, do the quasi-binomial, okay? But if you're unwilling to assume a particular form for that variance, then the next thing to do is to simply go back to what Bn actually is. Well, what is Bn? It's the true variance of the score function. Oh, what's the mean of the score function? It's 0. So that means that the variance of the score function is the expected value of UU transpose, right? So that means if I've got nothing else to go on, what can I use for Bn? 1 over n, sum of UU transpose. Take the average of them all. That gives us back the robust variance estimator. Okay, that is the same robust variance estimator that you guys used back in 211 as well. When I said just put in the residuals squared down the diagonal, those residuals squared were UU transpose down that diagonal. Okay. And so this is what we would term a moment-based estimator. Once I plug in UU transpose down here, this is a moment-based estimator for what the variance of the score function is.
So, the robust variance estimator then makes no assumption on what the V star is that's inside of that sandwich. It just goes ahead and empirically estimates this guy. Pros and cons there. The obvious pro is that they need to make an assumption about how to get it. Con is what?
You need data.
Data size, right, Francis? Because what am I relying upon here at the end of the day when you just look at that? Law of large numbers, right? That's what I'm relying upon here. And I'm relying upon the law of large numbers on the second moment, truly. Okay, it's 1 over n u transpose. So it takes a little while to converge down. Okay, so it usually means that you have to have reasonable sample sizes in order to get this guy to conversion. Yes, right?
So with overdispersed model parameterizations, is there a way to do, I guess you can do a likelihood ratio test since they're not nested, but how do people do model selection when it comes to choosing which sort of overdispersed model they have?
So if you're doing model selection in an inferential fashion, you'd want to scale the likelihood statistics by whatever you think the true variance is. And I'll talk to you about that in just a second. Okay. The easiest way that most people would do it is they would assume a quasi-binomial model, a scalar inflated model, and they would just scale down each of the statistics. I'm actually going to do that at the end of this lecture here. Okay. But as I get into saying, well, it's a negative binomial type of relationship, like on the last slide, so approach number 3, if you will, that we're going at here. The problem there is I'm not doing full maximum likelihood on a negative binomial model. What we're doing right now is we're doing a post hoc fix on a binomial fit. And we're saying, I've already fit the binomial model, I just need to fix up the variances for beta half. And so I really don't have the correct likelihood floating around at the end of the day. So if I pull that off, it's not going to be the negative binomial likelihood anymore. So that would not translate into a likelihood ratio test. But if I assume a scalar, that just means my likelihood ratio statistic is only off by a phi. I got to divide through ultimately by phi, as well as the end of the day. Okay. So good question. Ultimately, to kind of prelude where you may be thinking about going with that, Francis, is if you come to the robust variance estimator, now I've kind of given up on trying to specify even the right likelihood, right? I'm saying I don't even want to assume VI star. I just want to estimate the variances. Well, that means likelihood ratio tests are pretty much off the table. But what other type of test do I have at my disposal? Well, and what does the wall require me to have? Or require me to know? Not the likelihood. Beta hat, variance covariance for beta hat. And then whatever the distribution of beta hat is in our case, from Huber-White, we know it's normal though. Right? Okay. So what's going to happen, Francis, later on is to do testing either for a single variable or for multivariate, for multiple simultaneous tests of parameters. If you're going to use the robust variance estimator, you're going to have to resort to the wall test at the end of the day, because you don't have a likelihood. You kind of given up on the fact you specified likelihood.
Maybe you answered it. But I'm also done. But so choosing between beta binomial, robust variance, and quasi. The way we would look at it is through the wall test.
No, if you were going to do inference on the regression parameter.
Oh yeah, I don't care about that.
You're talking about choosing between the four
variables. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Good. So we're going to actually do that in just 1 second.
Okay.
We're going to talk about the pros and cons more in the context of this particular problem. Before I actually go and show you the results, and we talk about which one I would trust in practice and why. I want us to hypothesize something. And what I want us to hypothesize for just a second is what the relationship between the scale model in the case of the Beatles example, how those variance estimates would relate to the beta binomial model. So think about it for just a second. Go back to what that V star is. So in other words, the true variance here that we have for YI under the beta binomial. How does that relate to the quasi model in this case? Quasi binomial model. That's kind of a guess what Gillum's thinking, right? right now. Let me put it in a slightly different context. If M, I were constants, how would they relate to one another? They'd be the same, right? In other words, they'd both be off by the same constant scale factor. In that case, the same constant scale factor would be 1 plus M minus 1 times rho, if M was constant. In other words, if I had done a balanced experiment. Remember when I went back and said if I was designing this experiment, I would put exactly 30 beetles in every jar? That's because the beta binomial in that case would equate down to the scale exactly. But are we that far off from those two relating to one another? Not really. MI is not varying that much. And so the hypothesis that you should have floating in the back of your mind is when we do these two fixes, the result that we get from both of them should be pretty close to one another in terms of what the variance estimates are. Because MI is fairly constant across each of those jars. You guys with me on that? So that just basically becomes the scale factor times the binomial variance. If I had high heterogeneity in the sample sizes, like in the classroom example, not the case anymore. All right. So now let's go and implement each of these fixes. Okay. And I put my fixes in quotes because, again, we don't necessarily know the truth here. So each of them is going to revolve in some way, or at least a couple of them are going to revolve around the Pearson residuals. And that's because we have to get an estimate of phi, and then we also have to estimate rho. Okay. And so, a couple of things. So first I'm going to pull off my phi, or my Pearson residual values from my model fit. That's exactly what I had done before. So my estimate of phi, as we had done before, just the Pearson estimate, is going to be that good old 4.1793 that I had already done previously in the level. So now, this is part of your guys' homework assignment, and we'll discuss it on Monday. But I want you guys to convince yourselves that if I take those squared Pearson residuals, subtract 1, and divide by, in my notation, this is mi minus 1, that's going to be an estimate then of what rho is, a moment-based estimate. So think about how the overdispersion parameter relates down to the beta binomial variance model to get that estimate of rho, estimate of rho. Okay? So I want you guys to sit and think about it for just a little bit. And we'll come back to that. Notice over here I have to have exposed greater than 1. That's not a problem in our case. We always have more than 1 for the exposure. But in general, I wrote that there in case you had a situation where you had truly binary data. So if I do that, my estimate of rho from the beta binomial model is about 0.0914. Again, if I had truly independent binary observations, that would be 0. Most of you guys are looking at this, and when you see an estimate of correlation that looks like that, what do you think? You think, that's small, man. There's no correlation going on here. It turns out for binary observations, that's huge correlation for binary random variables. The correlation for binary random variables are bounded by something called the Frechet inequality, the Frechet bound. So Frechet, oh, now you're testing my French, I believe, Frechet was French. I might be able to get Frechet's name correct, but there's no way I will get the inequality correct because it's fairly complicated. So I wouldn't even attempt that one. But. So note, the correlation is bounded, and what I mean by that, of course, correlation is always bounded, right? Correlation is always bounded, minus 1 and 1, but what I mean is IE not by minus 1 to 1. And it's a function of the success probability, actually, to make it even more complicated, for each random variable. So in other words, if I had x1 and x2, x1 was Bernoulli with some pi 1, and x2 was Bernoulli with pi 2, the bound is going to depend upon pi 1 and pi 2. The key thing here is that you can't think about the magnitude of correlation for binary random variables the same way we do with continuous random variables. And you're seeing an example of it. What you would consider to be an extremely low correlation of 0.09 leads to a four-fold increase relative to the binomial distribution invariance. Okay, that's how dramatic that 0.09 actually is in a binary context. And I realize I've actually never still written the name of the bound, so I'm going to go ahead and do that now. So the bound is Fréchet's
extend to like categorical random variables for like iron response theory and stuff like that?
Yeah, so people have extended Fréchet's inequality from binary to discrete random variables as well. So,
okay.
And as you can imagine, as you start going discrete over multiple categories,
right.
That now starts to expand out.
Right.
And then, you know, basically as you go to continuous, it goes to minus 1.
Okay.
Exactly. Good. Okay. So, now I've got an estimate for a row. Let's go ahead and compute each of our variances then under the different assumed models. And then I'll come back to Francis's very important question, which is, you've given us too many choices, Gillen. Tell us which one to use all the time. There's got to be one answer all the time. You know it's not going to be that, right, Francis? It's not going to be just one answer.
It's
not. It's all going to be situation dependent to some degree. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is pull off my design matrix. So that's just a column of ones and then my log beetles concentration. I could have pulled this off the model fit, right? Just kind of a pop quiz for you guys. If I wanted that off of just the GLM fit, which function would I have used? For the get the design matrix. You remember this, right? If I go back over here and I do no, model.matrix. Model.matrix is a generic term, right, for all regression models inside of R. It's very handy, very useful to pull off the design matrix, especially if you've got things that are factored inside of there with indicators. You can always pull off the design matrix. That would have been an alternate way to do that. Okay, I just formed it by taking a column of ones in log concentrations. But that's it as well. Okay, so that's my capital X in my notation. I need to get mu. Well, that's great. I've got mu. That's just the fitted values that come from my GLM fit. Fantastic. V dot mu, that's my variance under the assumed model. So that looks like mu, or n times mu times 1 minus mu for each of those observations. And I'm going to put that into a diagonal for the matrix version of this. Estimating function. Well, what is my estimating function? This is my score, right? It looks like x times y minus mu. You guys with me there? Okay, so that's just the score estimating function from the GLM. And so now let's put everything together. The reason I'm getting the estimating function across, it doesn't show up in AN or BN, but where am I going to need to use it? The robust variance estimator, right? I need to have UU transpose. U is the estimating function here. Okay? All right. So now, Fisher information is going to be x transpose times w times x. That's what we had before. That's going to be, that's what I'm going to call it. So it's going to be x transpose v, that's the diagonal there, times x. And so I'm going to take the inverse of that, and that would give me ultimately what I would term my model-based standard errors. The reason I say that is because you fit a binomial model. Okay, so we typically refer to that statistics as the model-based standard errors. Those are the ones that are coming out of GLM. All right. Next, I can think about the quasi-binomial model, so the scale parameter. In that case, my standard errors will get scaled. I think Monticello brought this up. My variance will get scaled by phi. My standard errors will get scaled by square root of phi. Right? Just taking square root of everything. Okay, that's fantastic. So that gets me back to the quasi-binomial. And then finally, if I want the beta binomial variance, then I've got to formulate the sandwich, right? Which is Fisher information inside of the sandwich, Fisher information Vn. And so, you know, I did it as a vegetarian sandwich. I did that in honor of Patrick Hagerty, who's one of the godfathers of the stuff that taught me a lot of these things. And so he's a vegetarian, so we're going cheese on the sandwich. So the cheese of our sandwich then is x transpose m times mu times 1 minus mu, 1 plus our estimate of rho, m minus 1, okay, times x, which is exactly what we wrote down before. That's the cheese of the sandwich. So if I formulate then the standard error based upon the sandwich estimator, again, square root of Fisher information inverse, our estimate of what the true variance of the score is in the middle, and then Fisher information inverse on the other side. Great. Last one is the robust or empirical variance estimator. You will see the terminology gets used in different ways, okay? So you just gotta pay attention to the way people are referring to things. Sometimes they'll use empirical, which makes sense. It's an empirical estimate, it's a moment-based estimate of variance of u, okay? So there, I would just take UU transpose. In this case, this already started off as a row vector, so I'm taking estimating function transpose and estimating function. And that becomes then, if you will, the cheese of my sandwich. Okay. All right. So now, let's go ahead and compare the four, and then we'll talk for 1 minute about Francis's very important question here. So these are my estimates. Notice that the estimate has never changed here. These are what we call post hoc fixes for the variance again. I have one estimate for the beta, okay? That's based upon the binomial model. So now what I'm doing is I'm trying to think of how to fix the standard errors. Well, the scale is approximately 2 times the model base. We saw that because it's the square root of 4 times the model base standard error. Okay. The sandwich estimator that I talked about, that's the beta binomial. Remember what you guys told me. You guys said that should be fairly close to the scale. And that's because MI was roughly constant. So they're fairly close to one another. And then finally, the empirical is quite a bit different off of both of those guys. Actually, that's way more different than it should have been. Hold on. There's something. Is that what's in your guys' notes? I can't do this.
No.
Yeah. I missed something somewhere.
Why don't you
Just go into your GLM group.
So
what
do I see here, like, you need to, like, over the U. Hold on.
Oh, man, there's going to be this great punchline. We're going to talk about this thing.
I
pull up the wrong GLM.
To fix it, why don't you just get the GLM CI request equals?
Well, of course I can do that, but that's just going back to my code, right? Okay, so I will fix that in just a second. You know, I will actually, very quickly, I'll talk about it next time for you guys. That was quite a bit of work we had to do in each of those cases to get those fixed variances, right? So we had to go back and compute A and B. It turns out for the negative binomial model, you would have to do that in practice. The scale model has become so popular in practice that it actually is a family inside of GLM. So in other words, you can specify quasi-binomial on that family. So if I want the scale model, what I can do is change my fit to quasi-binomial as opposed to binomial. And that will estimate phi just the way we did and scale everything up by the square root of phi for the standard errors. Okay. And then finally, for the robust variance estimator, you can use my function on the course webpage. It's not built into the R program or into R for a GLM, but if you use robust.se.glm, that guy, based upon Francis's brilliant recommendation here, will give you back the robust standard error estimator, which those should now agree. So I've got to figure out what happened in my code. I must have dropped a one somewhere when I ran that through. One thing I want to point out is when you fit quasi-binomial and you type a summary right here, notice down at the bottom what is happening. It is saying now the dispersion parameter for the quasi-binomial family is taken to be the Pearson statistic, right? 4.18. So that's a scale on every one of those guys as you go through. So I'm going to let you guys go right now. So this is actually the robust variance estimator for the standard errors, which is not as far off as what you saw before. I apologize about that. So now, the question that Francis asked before I let you guys go, which one to use? Which one to use? You have four fixes. So first of all, does anybody vote for just the good old binomial? No, Brian, you're not allowed back in class anymore. The answer is you better not be using that one. You know you're off by at least fourfold on average in the variances. So now the question for me comes down to sample size. If my sample size is in the range of, 30 to 50 observations and above, same thing you guys simulated back in 2011, actually, where you saw the utility of the robust variance estimator, and I start to trust it, it starts to get stable. And that's my go-to guy or gal, okay, in practice, because I don't have to make a variance assumption in that case. I just fix it up and do it empirically, and I'll be consistent by the law of large numbers. If I'm in a case here, though, where what is my sample size truly? It's somewhere between 10 and 10 times 30, but there's correlation, pretty high correlation floating around the jars. So think about it more conservatively. So here, I would be less inclined to trust the robust variance estimator. And so what I would generally do is go for kind of a common fix. And in this case, it's kind of, it doesn't matter either way, because they're basically the same, the negative binomial and the quasi, but I'd probably go with the quasi binomial in this case. This is a scale factor on average to fix these things up. Because the robust variance estimator, it gets a little erratic. I wouldn't want to trust it too much in samples of size 10, okay? So, Do I really believe that it's truly a quasi-binomial model? In other words, that there's this simple scale that's out there and it's multiplied times the binomial? No, but it's a fix that's getting me on average correct standard errors. So that would be my answer to you. All right. Thanks, guys. We will see you next Monday. And I will fix that code. I'm going to fix it right now.